Welcome to our lecture online. Now let's try to summarize or trying to get our hands around how we deal with second order equations. So the first thing you want to do is make sure you have these two sets of equations handy. The set on the left involving the resistor in the circuit, the inductor in the circuit, and the capacitor in the circuit is an equation for the voltage across each of those three components. Notice that the voltage is equal to I times R. For the resistor, the voltage for the inductor is the inductance times the DIDT, the change in the current with respect to time, and then the voltage across the capacitor is 1 over C times the integral of I times DT. And then you want to convert those equations to solve those for the currents. So you can see that this is the current for the resistor, the current for the inductor, and the current for the capacitor. So have those three equations handy. The next you need to figure out how to draw the circuits. So you start with the original circuit. Notice the numbers here, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we're going to go in that order, but you start out by drawing the original circuit, and then you need to draw three more circuits. You need to draw a circuit for the time just before zero starts, for the time just after zero happened, and the time as it approaches infinity. So you're going to draw an equivalent circuit representing those three moments in time. Now notice that at t equals zero in this original circuit, the switch here opens up. So there's going to be some event that happens at t equals zero, and at that point you want to draw a picture of the circuit before that happens. You want to draw a picture of that circuit right after it happens, and then you want to draw a picture of the circuit after time has gone by for a long time and things have settled down into the state that it will be of when the time is sufficiently passed. So there's no longer any transient state at that point. So let's take a look here. We have a circuit with a voltage supply of 12 volts. We have a resistor, inductor. We have a resistor on this branch with a switch that opens up at t equals zero. And we have a capacitor at the end. And we want to calculate the voltage output across the capacitor and want to calculate the current through the circuit. So before the switch opens, what do we know? Well, for t equals zero minus, that's what it means, right before the switch opens, any inductor in the circuit will simply be like a short, meaning it doesn't offer any resistance to the current, assuming that there's steady state current, and any capacitor will act like an open circuit because the capacitor will be full of charge and no current will flow through the capacitor. So at that point, when we draw the circuit, we replace every inductor by a short, and every capacitor we open up the circuit. So when we do that, the inductor disappears, the capacitor is now an open circuit, and notice we now simply have a circuit like this, where the output voltage will be the voltage across the 2-ohm resistor. In that case, when we calculate the current right before we open the switch, the current will be the voltage divided by the resistance, 12 volts divided by a total of 6 ohms, which is 2 amps. The voltage on the output right here will be equal to the voltage across the 2-ohm resistor. So it's basically a ratio of the 2 ohms divided by the total resistance of 6 ohms. So the voltage across the open right here, across the capacitor, will be the voltage of the source times that ratio, 12 volts times 2 over 6, or 4 volts across the capacitor. Now time equals 0 happens. We open the switch. What happens now at time equals 0? We know that the current through the circuit right after the switch opens must equal the current for the circuit right before the switch opens, because current can't change that quickly. There cannot be an instantaneous change, so we know that the current continues from that point onward. Same with the voltage. The voltage across the capacitor before the switch open has to be exactly the same as the voltage across the capacitor after the switch opens, so we know that nothing changes at that very moment in time. But we do want to put in the inductor, we do want to put in the capacitor because now they're part of the circuit. And notice that as soon as the switch opened, this branch no longer carries current, so we can simply remove it. It's no longer necessary. So now we draw our circuit when we have this condition right here. And then finally, the third circuit you draw is when time approaches infinity. At that point, again, the inductor acts like it's simply a short. There's no longer a change in the current, so therefore it no longer offers any opposition. There's no voltage drop across that inductor. And then the capacitor will now be full of charge, and therefore it acts like an open. So now we replace the capacitor by an open, and we replace the inductor by a short. And now that's what our circuit will look like at the very end. And so you can see that there's no longer going to be any current flowing through it, and the voltage across the capacitor will now be equal to the voltage across the source. So using KVL, we can see that the current at the very end is equal to zero, and the voltage at the very end will be equal to 12 volts. So that's the basic approach, and we have an example here with a simple circuit. But again, the basic approach is you start with your original circuit, then you draw a circuit for time just before the event happens, in this case the opening of the switch. Then you draw a circuit just after the event happens, in this case opening up the switch. And then you draw a circuit when time has gotten sufficiently large, so basically when it approaches infinity, as we call it, so that the transient stage is over and now we have the final state of the circuit, and that's then your third circuit draw. And then remember that you'll probably need these equations to solve the circuits as we'll see them. But notice, original circuit, first circuit, second circuit, third circuit, so a total of four circuits to represent what happens when the event is about to happen, when the event just happened, and then after the event has gone by for a long time. And that's the general approach to solve second order equations and second order circuits. And that's how it's done.